Harper Audio presents The Crack Cocaine Diet by Laura Lippman, performed by Linda Emond. Copyright 2005 by Laura Lippman. Production copyright 2008 by HarperCollins Publishers.
The Crack Cocaine Diet. I had just broken up with Brandon, and Molly had just broken up with Keith. So we needed new dresses to go to this party where we knew they were both going to be. But before we could buy the dresses, we needed to lose weight, because we had to look fabulous. Kiss my ass, fuck you, fabulous. Kiss my ass, fuck you, and your dick is really tiny, fabulous. Because after all, Brandon and Keith were going to be at this party. And if we couldn't get new boyfriends in less than 8 days, we could at least go down a dress size and look so good that Brandon and Keith and everybody else in the immediate vicinity would wonder how they ever let us go. I mean, yes, technically, they broke up with us. But we had been thinking about it, weighing the pros and cons. Pro, they spend money on us. Con, they were childish. Pro, we had them. Con, tiny dicks, see above. See, we were being methodical, and they were just all impulsive, the way guys are. That would be another con, poor impulse control. Me, I never do anything without thinking it through very carefully. Anyway, I'm not sure what went down with Molly and Keith, but Brandon said if he wanted to be nagged all the time, he'd move back in with his mother. And I said, well, given that she still does your laundry and makes you food, it's not as if you really moved out. And that was that. No big loss. Still, we had to look so great that other guys would be punching our exes in the arms and saying, what are you, crazy? Everything is about spin, even dating. It's always better to be the dumper instead of the dumpy. And if you have to be the loser, then you need to find a way of being superior. And that was going to take about 7 pounds for me, as many as 10 for Molly, who doesn't have my discipline and had been doing some serious breakup eating for the past 3 weeks. She went face down in the ding-dongs, danced with the devil dogs, became a ho-ho, ho. As for myself, I'm a salty girl. And I admit I had the Pringles light can upended in my mouth for a couple of days. So anyway, Molly said, Atkins. And I said, not fast enough. And then I said, a fast, fast. And Molly said, she saw little lights in front of her eyes the last time she tried to go no food. And she said, cabbage soup. And I said, it gives me gas. And then she said, pills. And I said, all the doctors we knew were too tight with their scripts, even her dentist boss, and she stopped blowing him. And finally, Molly had a good idea and said, cocaine! This merited consideration. Molly and I had never done more than a little recreational coke, always provided by boyfriends who were trying to impress us. But even my short-term experience indicated it would probably do the trick. The tiniest bit revved you up for hours, and you raced around and around, and it wasn't that you weren't hungry, more like you had never even heard of food. It was just some quaint custom from the olden days, like square dancing. I mean, you could do it in theory, but why would you? Okay, I said. Only where do we get it? After all, we're girls, girly girls. I had been drinking and smoking pot since I was 16, but I certainly didn't buy it. That's what boyfriends were for. Pro, Brandon bought my drinks, and if you don't have to lay out cash for alcohol, you can buy a lot more shoes. Molly thought hard, and Molly thinking was like a fat guy running. There was a lot of visible effort. Well, like the city. But where in the city? On, like, a corner. Right, Molly, I watch HBO too. But I mean, what corner? It's not like they list them in that crap weekender guide in the paper. Movies, music, clubs, where to buy drugs. So Molly asked a guy who asked a guy who talked to a guy, and it turned out that there was a place just inside the city line, not too far from the interstate. Easy on, easy off, then easy off again. Get it? After a quick consultation on what to wear, jeans and t-shirts and sandals, although I changed into running shoes after I saw the condition of my pedicure, we were off. Very hush-hush, because As I explained to Molly, that was part of the adventure. I phoned my mom and said I was going for a run. Molly told her mom she was going into the city to shop for a dress, and we were off. The friend of Molly's friend's friend had given us directions to what turned out to be an apartment complex, which was kind of disappointing. I mean, we were expecting row houses, slumping picturesquely next to each other, but this was just a dirtier, more rundown version of where we lived. Little clusters of two-story townhouses built around a courtyard. We drove around and around and around, trying to seem very savvy and willing, and it looked like any apartment complex on a hot July afternoon. Finally, on our third turn around the complex, a guy ambled over to the car.
"What you want?"
"What you got?" I asked, which I thought was pretty good. I mean, I sounded casual, but kind of hip. And if he turned out to be a cop, I hadn't implicated myself. See, I was always thinking, unlike some people I could name.
"Got American Idol and Survivor. The first one will make you sing so pretty that Simon will be speechless. The second one will make you feel as if you've got immunity for life."
"Okay." Molly reached over me with a fistful of bills, but the guy backed away from the car.
"Pay the guy up there. Then someone will bring you your package."
"Shouldn't you give us the, stuff first and then get paid?" The guy gave Molly the kind of look that a schoolteacher gives you when you say something exceptionally stupid. We drove up to the next guy, gave him $40, then drove to a spot he pointed out to wait.
"It's like McDonald's," Molly said.
"Drive through." "Shit, don't say McDonald's. I haven't eaten all day. I would kill for a Big Mac."
"Have you ever had the Big and Tasty? It totally rocks."
"What is it?"
"It's a cheeseburger, but with, like, a special sauce."
"Like a Big Mac?"
"Only the sauce is different."
"I like the fries better when they made them in beef fat." A third boy, it's okay to say boy, because he was, like, 13, so I'm not being racist or anything, handed us a package, and we drove away. But Molly immediately pulled into a convenience store parking lot. It wasn't a real convenience store, though, not a 7-Eleven or a Royal Farms.
"What are you doing?"
"Pre-diet binge," Molly said. "If I'm not going to eat for the next week, I want to enjoy myself now." I had planned to be pure starting that morning, but it sounded like a good idea. I did a little math. An ounce of Pringles has like 120 calories, so I could eat an entire can and not gain even half a pound. And a half pound doesn't even register on a scale, so it wouldn't count. Molly bought a pound of peanut M&Ms, and let me tell you, the girl was not overachieving. I'd seen her eat that much on many an occasion. Molly has big appetites. We had a picnic, right there in the parking lot, washing down our food with diet cream soda. Then Molly began to open our package.
"Not here," I warned her, looking around. "What if it's no good? What if they cut it with, like, something, so it's weak?"
Molly was beginning to piss me off a little, but maybe it was just all the salt, which was making my fingers swell and my head pound a little.
"So how are you going to know if it's any good?"
"You put it on your gums."
She opened up the package. It didn't look quite right. It was more off-white than I remembered, not as finely cut. But Molly dove right in, licking her finger, sticking it in, and then spreading it around her gum line.
"Shit," she said. "I don't feel a thing."
"Well, you don't feel it right away."
"No, they, like, totally robbed us. It's bullshit. I'm going back."
"Molly, I don't think they do exchanges. It's not like Nordstrom, where you can con them into taking the shoes back even after you wore them once. You stuck your wet finger in it."
"We were ripped off. They think just because we're white suburban girls, they can sell us this weak-ass shit."
She was beginning to sound more and more like someone on HBO, although I'd have to say the effect was closer to Ali G than Sopranos.
"I'm going to demand a refund."
This was my first inkling that things might go a little wrong. So Molly went storming back to the parking lot and finds our guy, and she began bitching and moaning, but he didn't seem that upset. He seemed kind of, I don't know, amused by her.
He let her rant and rave, just nodding his head, and when she finally ran out of steam, he says, "Honey, darling, you bought heroin, not cocaine. That's why you didn't get a jolt. It's not supposed to jolt you. It's supposed to slow you down. Not that it seems to be doing that, either." Molly had worked up so much outrage that she still saw herself as the wronged party.
"Well, how was I supposed to know that?"
"Because we sell cocaine by vial color. Red tops, blue tops, yellow tops. I just had you figured for heroin girls. You looked like you knew your way around, got tired of OxyContin, wanted the real thing." Molly preened a little, as if she had been complimented. It's interesting about Molly. Objectively, I'm prettier. But she has always done better with guys. I think it's because she has this kind of sexy vibe, by which I mean she manages to communicate that she'll pretty much do anyone.
"Two pretty girls like you. Just this once, I'll make an exception. You go hand that package back to my man Gordy, and he'll give you some nice blue tops."
We did, and he did, but this time Molly made a big show of driving only a few feet away and inspecting our purchase, holding the blue-capped vial up to the light.
"It's like rock candy."
It did look like a piece of rock candy, which made me think of the divinity my grandmother used to make, which made me think of all the other treats from childhood that I couldn't imagine eating now. Pixie sticks, and now and laters, and Mary Janes, and dots, and black crows, and Necco wafers, and those pastel buttons that came on sheets of wax paper. Chocolate never did it for me, but I loved sugary treats when I was young. And now Molly was out of the car and on her feet, steaming toward our guy, who looked around very nervous, as if this 5'5", size 10 dental hygienist, size 8 when she's being good, could do some serious damage. And I wanted to say, "Dude, don't worry. All she can do is scrape your gums until they bleed." I go to Molly's dentist, and Molly cleans my teeth, and she is seriously rough. I think she gets a little kick out of it, truthfully.
"What the fuck is this?"
she yelled, getting all gangster on his ass. I think I'm saying that right. Holding the vial up to the guy's face while he looked around nervously. Finally, he grabbed her wrist and said,
"Look, just shut up, or you're going to bring some serious trouble to bear. You smoke it. I'll show you how. Don't you know anything? Trust me, you'll like it."
Molly motioned to me and I got out of the car, although a little reluctantly. It was like, you know that scene in Star Wars where the little red eyes are watching from the caves and suddenly those weird sand people just up and attack? I'm not being racist, just saying we were outsiders, and I definitely had a feeling all sorts of eyes were on us taking note.
"We'll go to my place," the guy said, all super suave, like he was some international man of mystery inviting us to see his etchings.
"A shooting gallery?" Molly squealed, all excited. "Oh, my God!"
He seemed a little offended.
"I don't let dope fiends in my house."
He led us to one of the townhouses, and I don't know what I expected, but it certainly wasn't someplace with doilies and old overstuffed furniture and pictures of Jesus and some black guy on the wall. Dr. Martin Luther King, Jr., I figured out later, but I was really distracted at the time and thought it was the guy's dad or something. But the most surprising thing was this little old lady sitting in the middle of the sofa, hands folded in her lap. She had a short, all-white afro and wore a pink t-shirt and flowery ski pants, which bagged on her stick-thin legs. Ski pants. I hadn't seen them in, like, forever.
"Antone," she said, "did you come to fix my lunch?"
"In a minute, Grandma. I have guests."
"Are they nice people, Antone?"
"Very nice people," he said, winking at us.
And it was only then that I realized the old lady was blind. You see, her eyes weren't milky or odd in any way. They were brown and clear, as if she was staring right at us. You had to look closely to realize that she couldn't really see, that the gaze, steady as it was, didn't focus on anything. Antone went to the kitchen, an alcove off the dining room, and fixed a tray with a sandwich, some potato chips, a glass of soda, and an array of medications. How could you not like a guy like that? so sweet, with broad shoulders and close-cropped hair like his granny's, only dark. Then, very quietly, with another wink, he showed us how to smoke.
"Antone, are you smoking in here? You know I don't approve of tobacco."
"Just clove cigarettes, Grandma. Clove never hurt."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.